Yeah, thank you very much. And thank you very much for inviting me to give this talk. This is really a pleasure, even though I would soon like a physical conference of some sort. Anyway, I would just say just a little bit about myself. My master's is in mathematics. I have a bachelor's in French and one in music. And my PhD is in neuroscience. Mainly, I consider myself a musician. Today I'm talking about predictive coding of music, and I'm going to present some rhythm stuff to you, also some melody stuff, and but mostly stuff on on rhythm. So the center for music in the brain is located here in this very nice building. We use these different scanning technologies. Before we had them all in the basement, but now we are a couple of kilometers away from them. So my talk is going to be about rhythm and meter, melody, groove, and interpersonal synchronization, which is a relatively new line, which I'm very interested in. So just to give you my view on what predictive coding of music is. Basically, the idea is that, as you have all been talking about in this conference, it's of course that the brain is trying to minimize prediction error in and what it does is basically that it takes its input and then it tries to fit the input to its model of the future, and that is you can say that's a process that is ongoing, and which both leads to our perception in relation to music, also action, and of course also learning and emotion of music. I'm not going to tire you with more formulas, but I'll just say that music is a particularly interesting topic for predictive coding, because you can say that there are different things that the brain needs to do. First, it needs to find a predictive model. And just as an example, we have this simple 3-against-4 rhythm that can be understood both as a 3-4 meter and a 4-4 meter. But the important thing is that it sounds very differently as to whether we figure or we think it's a 4-4 meter or a 3-4 meter. So if I, for instance, this rhythm would sound something like this: 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. So what you can hear is that it actually changes the way it sounds just by whether I count it off as in a 4-4 meter or a 3-4 meter. And this is, of course, very interesting. So let's say that we listen to this rhythm as a 4-4 meter, which would actually, for most Westerners, be very difficult to do, because we are more used to hearing this rhythm in a 3-4 meter. It might be different if you came to Africa, but this is pretty hard. But if we have it in a 4-4 meter, then our predictive model is 1, 2, 3, 4, strong, weak, strong, weak, strong, weak, strong, weak. And this is sort of, it gives us a prediction of when things are happening and at what strength, you can say, they're happening, or which accent it's happening. So this is basically the first thing we are doing when we listen to music in the rhythmic department. So, but this could, of course, in a sense, it's completely the same for melody and harmony, which relies on tonality. You can have a melody, for instance, like this one, where you have a melody that can be heard either as a C major or an A minor. Probably also could be heard as F major. But in principle, the tonality has the same It is the same thing as in rhythm, because the C major would be, if you heard the same melody in A minor, a C major melody, then your emotion would completely change to the absolute same piece of music. So music is a particularly interesting example of predictive coding, where you first have to sort of figure out what is the predictive model, and then you interpret the music after this. So let's go back to the rhythm and see what happens then. Now we say we have figured out, brains is figuring out that the courses of my input must be this 4-4 meter. Then when we listen to a rhythm, for instance, if it was just a 4-4 meter, it would be super boring, and our brain, there would be probably happening very little in our brains. If it was just 1, 2, 3, 4, we would get bored very soon. But most rhythms have syncopations, and a syncopation would be something like this: 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. And here you can hear that this 16th note is creating sort of something that is annoying to you. You need to resolve it in one way or the other. And as we have learned, this can either be by changing our predictive model. It's really hard because we really want to move in time with the music, so we want to move isochronously. So the other thing that you can do is you can act in order to sort of minimize this prediction error, so you can reinforce your meter by tapping your foot. And this is sort of a circular, this happens over and over again when you listen to this piece of music. So that might cause emotion, and over time you might also learn this. You could try to do this. It's not actually really easy to count for with this rhythm. But just to say a little bit of art, and I'm really not into aesthetics, or I don't know much about aesthetics, but just to say that maybe art is doing, all kinds of art is doing what this rhythm we were looking at before is doing, because what it does is that it creates these prediction errors, which are really hard to get rid of. They're really hard to explain away. So for instance, this is just a Danish artist, and I don't know, I haven't heard about him before, but I just saw this picture at our art museum. And you can see that what you are experiencing when you're looking at this this painting is these two bumps, and your gaze is probably going back and forth between these two bumps. They're really annoying, and that's simply because our schematic prediction is that we have a straight line which is going from one end to the other. So this is kind of prediction error that is impossible to get rid of. And to a slightly more well-known artist, Leonardo da Vinci, and I took this picture with my own camera just exactly 14 or 15 months ago, just before the coronavirus started. In Milan, and what you can see here is that you have this very nice sort of line, and then you have this annoying finger from Peter, who's asking Jesus something. So just to say that this is something that you basically see in all kinds of art. So another concept, of course, which is important: you have the model, you have prediction error, but you also need to understand the concept of precision weighting, which I know you're all familiar with, so I won't tire you too much with it. Just to say that our predictions are weighted by our confidence in our beliefs of how well our predictions are. So basically, you can see something like this, which was a study done by Martha Garrido, where she was placing the same sort of outlier in two different settings, a narrow and a broader distribution of pitches, And you can see that when you have the narrow pitches, when you're pretty certain about your prediction, then you get a larger mismatch negativity as measured by ET or MET. And we did sort of the same thing. Massimo Lumaca did this study with rhythm instead of sounds, where he had three different contexts, one which was completely isochronous, one where the rhythm was low entropy, where there was a little bit of a difference, and then a rhythm that was more complex. And then he placed two types of deviance, rhythmic deviance, one which was a small deviant, 100 milliseconds, and one which was a big deviant. And what he found was, not surprisingly, that if you have the small deviant in the very simple context, the isochronous context, you get a large mismatch negativity, a large prediction error. In the low entropy situation, you had a smaller prediction error, and if you had a very complex stimulus, rhythmic stimulus or context, you get a small prediction error. But interestingly, there's a ceiling effect to this, because if the deviation is large enough, you see the same size of the mismatch negativity, the same amplitude of the mismatch negativity in all three cases. We also did the kind of the same idea in a melodic context. This was done by David Quiroga. And what he used was an old paradigm of ours, which is the Mumufu paradigm. It's called that. It's a multi-feature MMN paradigm, where you have a melody, bum 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 bum, and then you place different deviants at different places. But what he did was that he made different versions of this, so different melodies that were more and more had more and more entropy, which you can measure, by the way, by Marcus Pierce's idiom model, and so that it would be more and more complex. So the regular here was bum 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 bum, and so forth. And then a more elaborate melody, ba da 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 do do da do da 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 da, and so forth. And you had a random melody also, and a very broad and very unpredictable melody. So we did different melodies, melody types with different, which were more or less predictive. So, or increasingly predictive. So what we found was then what he did was then he placed a deviation, a deviant, but a pitch deviant at different places in this sequence for a behavioral study. And what you can see here is that means that the D prime, the more unpredictable the melody or the context becomes, even though it's exactly the same deviation, then the D prime, which is of course a sensitivity to the signal in the noise, will go down. Here the idea is that we have two different conditions, one which is low entropy, very predictable, Alberti base, and one which is high entropy, and then we place four different types of deviants in these situations. And what you can see here is that you have deviants, you have a clear effect of context. So in the Alberti base, the low entropy, very predictable, you get a large mismatch negativity compared to the high entropy, where you get a smaller mismatch negativity, amplitude of the mismatch negativity. And that is both for pitch and slide, which are both pitch related. But if you place deviants which are not related to the parameter where you have the complexity, which is not pitch related, then you see the same in the two conditions. And I think in the interest of time, I'll skip this, but it just shows you that when you learn something, then you change the connectivity between areas in the auditory cortex, so that which is an indication that when you learn stuff, then you get a more precise prediction. Anyway, I would like to go a little to the rhythm department, and I'll play you a song which you all know and which all probably have been moving your feet to in one way or the other. So, even though I don't dance, then I surely feel the urge to move. And this is something that we have been interested in a number of years, and it's very interesting in relation to predictive coding. Because if you think about it, what you need to have in order to be wanting to move is you need some kind of prediction error, and in the melody, this is created by syncopations. If you look at this melody, 'cause I'm happy, then you have a syncopation on this note, and you also have clap along if you feel like a room without a roof. So you basically can see how this song creates these or tries to create some kind of prediction error to the pulse, the meter. Sensation of the meter that we feel. And Maria Witek did this wonderful study where she made different types of drum rhythms, very simple ones, some which were very complex, and some which were just in the middle. And what she could show was that if you ask people of how much they want to move, then there's sort of a sweet spot for the movement and the pleasure that we feel. And that sweet spot is actually pretty narrow. So it's only right in the middle you really feel this wanting to move. And together with Thomas Matthews, we did a follow-up on this where we were where we had both rhythmic complexity in three different grades, low, medium, and high, and a low, medium, and high complexity in harmony. So, and just to make you hear how this sounds, then the low condition sounds something like this. Yeah, thanks. I think we heard it. The high complexity, where you both have high complexity in the rhythm and the harmony, sounds something like this. And then you have the medium complexity, which sounds something like this. So, as I just was saying, then you can see that you get exactly the same kind of inverted U-shaped curve where you like the medium syncopated rhythms the most. And if you then contrast the high against the medium syncopated rhythms, then you see both activity in the premotor areas. Premotor cortex, SMA, and the basal ganglia, and which is makes complete sense because you are lying in an MR scanner, you can't move, but you really want to move. And we also saw activity in the left medial orbital frontal cortex, which is part of an important node in the reward network. So, how can we understand this in a predictive coding way? And I was thinking a lot about this, and I came up with this very simple explanation. So if you think about it, when we increase the syncopation, then this is something that we can measure, and it's completely, you can measure it in the stimulus, so you have, objectively, you have this increasing line in the stimulus. But what happens when we listen to these rhythms is that our precision of the meter probably goes down, because some of these rhythms, it's really hard to get the four beats in the meter. And this, I've tried to show it here on the right to your screen, that the your precision broadens here around each beat, and probably it completely collapses in the end here. So if you time these together, the precision, you time this with the precision, you get the precision weighted prediction error, which gives you a nice U-shaped curve. So do we have any evidence? This is, of course, completely theoretical. Do we have any evidence to support this? So if you play these rhythms to people and ask them to move freely to them, then what happens is that you will actually see exactly this sort of line going down here. The precision decreases when the complexity goes up. Another thing that we found was this very interesting, because we asked people both about how much do you want to move, and how much pleasure do you feel. And what we found here was that, very interestingly and very convincingly, I think, was that harmonic rhythmic complexity influences directly your wanting to move, but harmonic complexity sort of works through pleasure. So that's also why we don't have rhythms on when we want to dance. It's not just rhythm, we actually also have some other instruments playing to increase the pleasure rating. And if you just play the harmonies alone to people, then you also see an inverted U shape here. But what you also see is, again, convincingly, that musicians prefer higher complexity than non-musicians. So the peak of this U-shaped curve is different, differently located than in the non-musicians. And also, interestingly, a study I did with Georgios Karageorgis in Brunel University is that when you need to learn to move to music, you need music to be as simple as possible, which is not always what happens when you, are trying to learn to dance. No experience from my part in that thing. Now I'll turn to the last part of my talk, and I'll talk about some stuff we have been doing recently, but I think this is very interesting in a predictive coding framework. That's interpersonal synchronization. And of course, music is extremely interesting as a model of interpersonal communication, even though it can be organized very differently in a classical setting as compared to jazz quartet or quintet, as in this case, for instance. But just to give you an idea why I think predictive coding is important, I think that when we make music together, that means that if we play music together, or we sing together, or we dance together, or clap together, then we need to coordinate our predictive frameworks. Super crucial. And I'll just give you an example of this from Anita O'Day's performance at the Newport Jazz Festival in 1958, T for Two. I would recommend you to watch the whole thing on YouTube. It's really fascinating. But I would just like you to try to figure out where the downbeat is. And you can, just listen.
Picture me upon your knee, T for two and two for two. Can't you see how happy we could be? Nobody near us, see us here. It's friends, we live together. Cash, you won't have it now. We own a telephone there. Dawn was breaking, you waved me to bake a sugar cake. You to take my olive voice. See, we were just a family boy. For you get a for me, can't you see? Can't be, we can be, we three. Look to me, I find you need two for two and two for two. Now can't you see? Can't be, we can be.
Yeah. As a bonus information, I should say that she has later told the public that she was so high on heroin that she couldn't even she was having a hard time just standing up. But she kicked the habit in the 60s, and she lived actually until pretty recently. Anyway. As you probably figured out, it was not easy to find the downbeat. And just to reassure you, the downbeat is this one. And this, of course, poses a couple of questions. How do we synchronize these temporal predictions when we make music together? Who leads and who follows in these interactions? And what are the brain mechanisms that allow us to synchronize? And for the last one, there is, of course, this mutual prediction theory that proposes that each individual has brain mechanisms that control their own behavior as well as mechanisms that predict the behavior of their partner. And another thing that I think is crucial for the next couple of slides is that the beta band bursts, they are thought to be sort of a marker of this prediction process. So when you tap, for instance, the idea is that you tap in, for instance, this tempo, bum, 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 bum. But then there's an underlying fast oscillation of the beta band around 20 hertz, which goes up and down and sort of makes us predict the next beat. So the brain is going something like this. And we'll get back to that. But one of the simplest ways that we can actually study this is the joint finger tapping paradigms, which we have been doing for a number of years. And here two individuals sit in isolated rooms and listen either to themselves or their tapping partner. They might be able to also see their tapping partner in certain conditions. We'll get back to that. The first study we did with this was Ivana Konvalinka, who showed that when people are tapping together in two rooms and can hear each other, then the most normal, what you see most often is the so-called mutual adaptation. And that actually means that when one person is speeding up, then the other person is speeding up on the next beat, but then the first person slows down, and then the person who was speeding up actually slows down on the next beat and so forth. So it's kind of a mutual adaptation. And this, of course, happens without any consciousness to this. This is basically happening so fast that this is almost subliminal. But, so this was the first study that we did. And then the second study we did was an oxytocin study that showed that where we gave some diets, we gave oxytocin through a nasal spray. Other diets, we gave a placebo. And what we could show was that there was the oxytocin diets were better at synchronizing, in especially in the unidirectional condition. But if, I mean, it does mean that you should give oxytocin to classical symphony orchestras, because they actually were worse at keeping the tempo. So, but anyway, what I find really interesting is the next couple of studies, because what we then did was that we tried to make a condition where the two persons have two different predictive models. So that means that one person is thinking of the same, of the thing that he's tapping as a 4/4 meter, and the other is thinking about it as a 3/4 meter. And what Ole Adrian Hegley was able to show was that if you have the same model, you quickly get a nice synchronization. But if you have different models, it takes, here it's actually 8 beats, but it takes some time before you have harmonized your two predictive models. This is super interesting because, in a sense, this condition is harder to do than I mean, the same model, having the same model, it can be harder to do than having different models. So the next thing that Ole did was that he took all of the data from Ivana's study and his own study. And Ivana's study was non-musicians. His own study was only musicians because they had to do this polyrhythm stuff. And he collapsed them and he showed the different types of relationship at how they the leader-follower relationships. And so most of the diets would display this mutual adaptations. Some of them would be, there would be one who was leader, so one person who is not reacting to the other person who is then following the first person. But what he also found was, very interestingly, that there also is a third way to synchronize, and that's leaders. And that means actually that the two persons are following just their own beat, they're not adapting to the other. And interestingly, these are some of the ones that synchronizes the best. And the reason why is that these were always the ones where we had people who were really good at just keeping the tempo with a metronome. And most of them were drummers. Not these two drummers though. Alex Riel is the most famous Danish drummer. He has been in Denmark. He's 80 years old now. He's been playing in my quartet for many years. Of course, Jack Dejanet, you all know, I hope. It's really good. But what we wanted to do also was to try to model this synchronization using a simple oscillator model. And since I'm running out of time, I'm not going to explain this very clearly to you. I'm not going to show you this thing, but I just want to tell you how simple the mathematics is behind this. The idea is simply that if you have two different oscillations, they both have a preferred tempo. Let's say two people walking together, they have a preferred tempo. But when they are together, they couple, and they can have a coupling constant that then works on the phase between the two. And that means the bigger the coupling constant is, or the larger it is, the more synchronized these two oscillators become. And what we were able to show was that if we just take two oscillators, one per person, it's not possible to model these leader-follower relationships. But if you have four oscillators, and you can think of about this as one oscillator in each person for action and one in each person for perception, then it's actually possible to quite really well model the relation, these different types of relationships. And just to explain this, in the leading situation, you would have a stronger internal coupling than external coupling. For the mutual adaptation diets, you would have a stronger external coupling. Of course, they place a big weight on the other person. And the leading following relationships, you have an asymmetric relationship. And as you can see from the Bottaccheria coefficient down here somewhere, this is really well explained in most cases. So we of course recorded EEG using this leading eigenvector analysis, which is a method to study connectivity between brain areas giving a certain pulsation. And it estimates basically how much time the individual brain spends in a certain network and how often this network happens. And what we found was differences in the alpha range when we compared the mutual adapters to the leading diets. And we saw this, and that this state that they were engaging in could be described as a sort of an action perception network consisting of course, auditory and motor regions, the temporoparietal junction and pecuneus, which was actually recently in a paper by Wong and colleagues described as a lower part. Here you have their paper, and it was described as this lower part of the theory of mind network, which of course makes good sense since these things are happening subliminally. But this of course gives us crucial information about what separates different types of interaction dynamics. But What are then the brain mechanisms that underlie our ability to both keep our own beat while at the same time incorporating the beat of others, if you should think of this mutual prediction theory? And we have just recently collaborated with Mattia Rossi from Marc Lehmann's lab, and he actually came up with a brilliant idea for studying this. Here you have two persons who are tapping to two different metronomes, but these metronomes are moving at slightly different tempi. And as you can see, one is just a little bit faster than the others. And that means that when they start out with the same phase, but then they become uncoupled and they move to the anti-phase and back in phase again. And in the study, this took around 40 seconds. And they in each condition, they did this 10 times. So the conditions were either uncoupled, so they were just listening to themselves and doing it, or they were coupled either by them watching the other person or listening to the other person. And of course, what happened when you have no visual coupling, you don't have any dyadic coupling strength. You don't have any coupling between the two persons that you can see on their tapping. But if you can see each other, then something really interesting happens. When your face is close to zero, so you are actually very close to the other person, then you start coupling with the other person. So you sort of drift from your own metronome, even though you are asked to keep the rhythm. So, and when they are in anti-phase, you don't have any coupling. And of course, this was not the most important thing that we did, because what we wanted to do was to analyze or use EEG on both participants. And what we did was we wanted to extract the beta oscillations, as I told you before, from each tapper's EEG. And what you do is basically you extract it just from the EEG and you filter it, and then you make it a Hilbert transform, and then you end up with a beta power which is for each time point at the cycles. And what we then did was, or Mattia did, to be honest, then he coupled this with your own finger tapping, so that and the other person's finger tapping, so that you can see whether there is this beta modulation as a function of your finger tapping and maybe also the other person's finger tapping. And what we found was really, really interesting, I think, because of course, if you have no visual coupling or no auditory coupling, you get this very nice beta band burst modulation of your tap. So here's the tap, and here you have sort of the beta band modulation. But if you're coupled, then you actually also see this not as strong, but the same kind of modulation of the beta band burst as a function of the other person's tap. And this is not visible when you don't have a coupling. And if you have the auditory coupling, where they can listen to both their own tap or their own metronome, but also the other person's tap, then you get distracted when you are close to the zero phase. So when they're very close together, you get distracted, and you can see how this is actually skewing your own curve also. And you see a very clear beta band burst of the other person's tapping also. I think this is super interesting. I'll sort of finish here, but I'll just summarize the last studies for you, which are the newest one, to say that joint finger tapping can be categorized into three different types of interaction: mutual adaptation and leading following and leading dyads, and this can be modeled by two sets of Kuramoto oscillators and is reflected differently in the action perception brain networks as measured with EEG. And in the tapping conditions with different predictive frameworks, a waltz or a march, this leads to bad synchronization at first, followed by normal synchronization after a few bars. And this indicate either that you harmonize the meters or you integrate the other's model into your own model. So The tapping of different tempos with visual or auditory coupling leads to increased beta modulation by both self and other movement cycles, both in the visual and the auditory situation. And what I haven't shown you is the behavioral data that shows that people felt a decreased sense of control and increased perceived task difficulty, of course. And this is very interesting because this gives us actually a way, or it actually gives us a marker for the mutual prediction theory. And it also, and if you think about these beta oscillations, we probably reflect your top-down predictions, and that fits very well with the idea that the gamma band oscillations relay prediction error signals in the bottom-up direction, and the beta band is the top-down predictions. So anyway, in our upcoming Nature Reviews neuroscience review, which I have written together with Ole Adrian Heckley, Carl Friston, and Morten Kringenbach, we have proposed a predictive coding model for thinking about how to what happens when we make music together. And what I've been mainly I just want to say one thing. You can read the paper later this year, but what I've been mostly talking about is the harmonization of schematic predictions, where as what this model proposal is that we harmonize both schematic, veridical, and dynamic prediction, but at different time scales. So I think I'll just stop here and thank all my co-authors and all the fantastic and wonderful people that I have in my center, and say thanks for listening. And